And that brings us to the analysis of Shields and Brooks. That is syndicated columnist Mark Shields and New York Times columnist David Brooks. Gentlemen, we're going to be lashed at the hip, I think, next week. You're heading to Cleveland, and we don't know whether there's going to be disruptions or not. But, Mark, let's start by talking about Donald Trump setting the table. He's now chosen his running mate, Mike Pence. What do you think? We just heard from a reporter in Indiana. What do you make of this?
I think Mike Pence was the least Trump-like of the three finalists. In that sense, he makes sense. He's got conservative, solid conservative credentials, especially with social conservatives. And he's articulate. He's personable. And he's got national ambitions. He's made no secret of them in the past. I just remind him that it's a successful vice president, an unsuccessful vice presidential candidate has been elected president of the United States exactly once in the nation's history. I mean, remember President Joe Lieberman, President John Edwards.
You said unsuccessful.
An unsuccessful Franklin Roosevelt, who lost in 1920 and got elected in 1932. But so it's not necessarily a road to the White House on an unsuccessful vice presidential campaign. So, but he makes sense for Trump, given Trump's special problems.
Makes sense. Oh, we'll let you explore that.
Special problem.
Makes sense.
Yeah, I think special needs.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I think so. Of the three that were available to him, it wasn't like everyone was available to him, and so he picked the one who does not cause him any problems. I got to know Mike Pence. I first met him in the early 90s. He was a talk radio host in Indiana, and I think his slogan was, "I'm the Rush decaf Rush Limbaugh."
That's right. It was.
And so he was less spicy, and his demeanor is sweet and kind, and in the House he was successful because he's a nice guy, genuinely nice guy. But if he was a decaf Rush Limbaugh, I don't know what he is to Donald Trump, I think he'll disappear, frankly. I think it's a less important vice presidential pick than any we've had, just because Trump is his own show. And he hasn't promoted a rival show. He's just going to be his own show. And Pence will appear at the vice presidential debate, but I'd be surprised if we were talking too much about him for the next few months.
So one quick point, Judy, that Trump said that he wanted an attack dog, someone who could be a pit bull or whatever. And Mike Pence is the opposite of that. He ran for Congress in 1988 and 1990 against a longtime Democratic incumbent, Phil Sharp, in that district. And he lost twice. And after the second defeat, he wrote an article entitled Confessions of a Serial Negative Campaigner. And he apologized for running negative ads and so forth. And that, I mean, that does not sound like an attack dog to me.
Yeah, unless they wanted a Midwestern antacid
sweet,
or something compared
sweet
to Donald Trump.
Yeah.
But what does it say that we've been hearing in the last 24, 48 hours, David, about Donald Trump maybe having second thoughts at midnight last night? There was the back and forth. He told one interviewer, I'm close to a decision. I want somebody on national security. And then he told somebody else, no, it's down to three. I mean, what do you make of this whole process?
Well, this is not a real campaign. Like, there's a certain norm of the way things are done. Usually when you announce your vice presidential candidate, there's like a professional rollout. Like, you do trivial things like updating your webpage, which the Trump campaign didn't do for a little while.
That's right.
And so, you know, it's a one-man show, and one gets the impression everyone else around is sort of in the dark, and Trump's deciding or not deciding. And as a result, you know, the normal institutional presence that a campaign has, where decisions get made and things get done and conventions get organized, a lot of that, it's unclear if that's happening.
Well, and speaking of that, Mark, and I mean, comment on how they've handled the Pence rollout. But here we are, two or three days ahead of the start of the convention. We still, as far as I know, as of an hour ago, didn't have the schedule. We don't know who's speaking in what order. The kinds of things that the candidates normally do. Does that matter? I mean, can he just put on a great show and that's all that really counts?
Well, I think a convention, whether it's for the Elks or for the aluminum siding industry or for a party, is basically the same thing. It has to energize the people who are there, to validate them, to unite them. And in Donald Trump's case, I think it's to run a normal convention. And one where he's not in any way criticizing or censuring Republicans who aren't there, that he rises above, shows a spirit of magnanimity. I think that's it, perhaps a lot more important than whether Bobby Knight stiffs him and Don King doesn't show up and Mike Tyson is invited.
Yeah, I do think that that's one of the keys for this convention. I mean, for me, I want to see at least 30 or 40 members of the Trump family actually speaking at the podium, which it seems like we're getting close to that number. But I do want, it'll be curious to know how organized it is, because if they can't organize a convention, how do you organize an administration or a fall campaign? And then the emotional tone. Conventions are like coronations, but if you watch the Trump speeches leading up in the last couple of weeks, it's filled, it's sour. He's sour. He's filled with resentment. People aren't treating me nice. CNN
is
too mean.
Right. Yeah.
And so that's not a normal convention mood. So it'll be interesting to see if he can pivot and actually be happy.
And on top of that, you have these world events that we're following, this awful attack, Mark, last night in France with, you know, all so many people killed in this sort of unspeakable act by this man who drove his truck through the crowd. And then tonight, we're watching and trying to understand what's going on in Turkey. What effect do events like this have on a presidential election?
Well, there's a certain numbing effect right now. I mean, it's crisis upon crisis. I mean, tragedy upon tragedy. And I mean, I think we're reeling, quite honestly. And Nice was just, you know, of a different order of magnitude. I mean, the idea of driving a truck through families and people celebrating Independence Day at 70 miles an hour and not slowing down.
But does it mean that, I mean,
as far as our politics
that Americans want a leader who's more stable or someone who's going to change things?
I mean, I think there's always in the short run the call for bold action over thoughtful, restrained action has an appeal. I mean, people are enraged. They're insecure. They're unsure. And the sure, certain trumpet that sounds has an appeal at a time like that. I mean, it's not like we're on the eve of an election, not whether Donald Trump has a program or the credentials, but he is the bold voice as opposed to the voice of restraint and experience that Secretary Clinton purports to offer.
Yeah, I don't think Trump would exist as a viable candidate if not for this climate for the past couple of years of psychological blows the world has endured. You know, you start with the economic stuff, anxiety, which is of long-standing nature, but you go back to the beheadings, the ISIS beheadings. These were psychologically damaging for the country, and what we felt last week, we were on the show last week, it was rough.
Yeah.
It was a very depressing week, and then this week is worse. And what's going on in Turkey, it's just the world is spinning out of order. And so that implicates the campaign in two ways. This campaign is in part a debate between an ardent nationalist, which Donald Trump is sort of a European-style blood-and-soil nationalist, versus a candidate on the Democratic side who's more of a globalist, who believes in global institutions. And if this be, and these attacks all around the world, we see the dark side of globalization. And so I do think they help Trump. And then to me, the interesting thing is people are going to want order, as Mark said. They're going to want somebody who can preserve order. Normally, that means they want experience, and that would be good for Clinton. But I think in this climate of chaos, they're going to want toughness and the sort of like this authoritarianism, and that's sort of up more Trump's alley.
Even when there's no link, I mean, no proven link yet. For example, in France, this man who drove this truck, Mark, they still don't have a connection between him and ISIS. It could have been the act of one person disgruntled, upset with his life.
You're right, Judy. But to David's point, it's nationalism too. I mean, he was a Tunisian, of Tunisian origin and descent, so he was the other. I mean, and I think there's very much, that is very much in our politics. When David raised the point about chaos in the world, this is why the convention is important, and Donald Trump's comportment are. I mean, because this should be an advantage to him right now as the out party and the one who's been preaching this message of nationalism. But he does projected chaos. I mean, and I think to that degree that it'll hurt him if, in fact, at the convention in Cleveland, he personally exemplifies or represents chaos, or the convention itself does. I mean, I think that's a high risk for him.
It should be said that New York Times CBS poll came out this week and it showed Clinton and Trump tied at 40. And what's interesting about the polls over the past couple months is that he doesn't move. He's at 40. She rises and falls, but he doesn't move. And so a lot of this climate is, I think, more affecting her vote somehow than his vote.
And that poll, those polls, I guess, and she did slip, I guess, came after the really bad week she had with the, yeah. with the release
some
of the emails.
Some of it was the emails, but I think some of it was also just the Dallas, the police killing, somehow mm-hmm. the sense of social unraveling, all the comparisons people were making to 1968.
She did this past week. It seems like it was forever ago, but it was just Tuesday. She did get the endorsement of Bernie Sanders, who held out for a long time, Mark. Is that, how much of it, go ahead. How
well,
much
I think
is
the
that
timing
gonna...
was better. I mean, if anything, she did need a lift this week. I mean, after the Comey and the emails and after Dallas and after Baton Rouge and after Minnesota, she needs, Secretary Clinton needed a lift, and I think Bernie Sanders' endorsement gave her a lift. I mean, if it had come 2 weeks earlier, as so many Clinton folks were urging and exhorting him to do, I don't think it probably would have given the kind of upper that she did need at that time, even in the midst of a week in which it was very much eclipsed. But Bernie made a good case for her candidacy, basically based on Bernie's campaign.
I was going to say, how enthusiastic how
well,
was
no,
it?
No, I mean, that's it. I mean, nobody delivers. We don't deliver anything in this country anymore, Judy. I mean, nobody delivers votes, but I mean, his enthusiastic endorsement of her and party unity are going to be important.
Yeah, what do you think?
I think the Democratic Party will be united. I've always thought that. She has now 85% of his vote. By the end of the convention, it'll be 90-something. It'll be united. I think what's changing is, are his issues on the forefront anymore? And so if we look around the world right now, are the banks really what people are fearing most? Or is it ISIS? Or is
it
racial issues that have suddenly risen to the fore? And so I think some of his issues, at least for the time being, are being eclipsed. And so that changes the landscape for her.
Well, and speaking of one of those, we've almost forgotten to mention there was another terrible, there were shootings. We've been watching, Mark, of black men by police, but then we had, just within the last week, the terrible massacre of police officers in Dallas. And then there was this quite remarkable memorial service this week. And you were telling us earlier today, it may be the one bright spot.
It was the one bright spot for me in the whole week. I mean, it was almost traditional. It was what Americans have come to expect at a time of crisis and tragedy, and that is bipartisanship. I mean, Ted Cruz, one of the president's archest critics, flew down on Air Force One with him. John Cornyn, the Republican leader in the Senate, deputy leader, introduced the president. President George W. Bush, I thought, gave a quite personal Dallas perspective. And the president is comforter in chief. He does it so well. The police chief of Dallas, David Brown, both Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump ought to be grateful that he hasn't entered any of the races. I mean, he's just so impressive. And I just thought there was a sense of unity, of reconciliation, of national agreement that Dallas ceremony.
And I have to say, that's what real America is. I've been on this little tour of the country last several months to San Antonio or New Mexico or Fresno or West Virginia. And the country is filled with healers, people healing the social fabric. And we get down, the news events are horrible.
We focus on the bad things.
But there is a day-to-day reality, and it's actually a little closer to what President Obama was saying than sometimes to coup and some of the horrible events mm-hmm. that we do have to cover, obviously.
Well, it's a better note to end on than most of the news tonight. David Brooks, Mark Shields, thank you both, and we'll see you in Cleveland.
Thank you. Look forward to it.